they in can't real have pain. It.
Yeah, this one is quiet, but this other one is like, and you can totally see that they are in real pain. Of course, us as humans, of course, the first thing that we'll run to is this one who is in a lot
who
of pain.
Is in a lot of pain.
Yeah.
Now there comes in the who, you know, for being a priority when you're attending to someone, there are priorities you give to.
Yeah.
One is this victim breathing. Okay, right, because if you're not breathing, then that means there is a problem.
Yes.
If you're screaming, there's no way you'll be screaming and you're not breathing.
And you're not breathing, true.
So yes, I understand you.
You're in pain. Yeah.
But someone who is quiet, I don't know whether they are breathing.
Yeah.
There could be an obstruction of the airway.
True.
That's why I have to attend to them first.
All right, all right.
But once I go and rectify and I see they are breathing, then I can still be attending to you at the same time.
Right.
So you see, for your case, you're screaming, but I can give you an instruction on what to do.
On what to do. Okay.
Yes. Makes then sense. You go back again now to the principles. Again, it's calling for help, which I tend to see most of us now. We fail because most of us, we don't have emergency numbers. And you go, perhaps I could even ask viewers, how many of us or how many out there they have
emergency numbers.
And emergency numbers is for the police, the fire brigade and the ambulance. In this case, an ambulance service. Maybe we see them, you know, wailing, but do we have their direct number to call them?
Yeah.
Because now that would be a problem for you if you want to call. But the good thing is now the national numbers that are working, the 999, the 999, 911, and 112.
All right.
Those are going to a command center, which is managed by the police. Then they will ask you what is your emergency, and they will commence. They will see, they will try to help you out. Then there are also other numbers that are toll-free, which is 1199. That goes to Kenya Red Cross ambulances, and even the medical facilities. So even where you live, if you have a nearby medical facility or a hospital, it is important to have their numbers. And now, again, it's important again to have their numbers for the ambulances.
Yeah.
So those are the general principles that you always remember. If you can always remember that, then it makes your case a bit easier. Now, finally, is on the principles is you need to be safe and avoid cross infection.
Which most of the time, in the case of an emergency, we forget.
Yes.
All right? Yeah.
And the cross infection can come in here, that you, because you might have a multiple casualties. So you're attending to this and the other and the other and the other. You may have one pair of gloves.
Or maybe not. True.
Then you're touching this, you touch the other, you're touching the other. So what happens is infection is a two-way traffic.
Yeah.
Either I get it from you or you get it from me.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's how the infection would be. So it is, you try as much to avoid that. You try as much as to avoid. So I know it's not all the time you'd want to go and be touching someone's blood. But some points now you do not have any other way. But if you get now exposed to, the right thing to do is you go to the hospital, the nearby medical facility. And you tell them, well, I was attending to a casualty, and I think I got exposed to, maybe because I have a cut or maybe I touched blood. And they will give you a treatment which is free, which is called PEP, post-exposure prophylaxis. But usually, it usually takes, once you get exposed, the earlier you go to the hospital, the better.
The better.
But it usually takes about a phase of about 72 hours. But the earlier you get to the hospital, the better.
The better.
So that's what you try as much to. Those are, if you ensure those principles are always followed. I know some points they are tricky, but those are general. It doesn't matter which country you're in, it doesn't matter what situation it is about, but those are majorly the basic
the
principles that everyone or anyone ought to follow.
Okay.
Yes.
And then we also talked about an aspect of first aid kit, which is very, very important. But not all of us have them in our houses.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
And again, I think, I don't know if it's out of ignorance or I don't know if it's just culture thing where we don't want to keep these things because sort of like we'll bring in bad omen and then people start getting hurt left, right and center in this house. But it's very, very important, all right, to have just a basic first aid kit. And just in passing, because of course we'll have demonstrations a little bit later on. So then what, because one might have a first aid kit, but then it doesn't have anything inside, or the contents are not safe for use at a particular time. So just talking about a basic first aid kit, what should be in there, and after, let's say, it has not been used for a particular time, mm-hmm. should it be disposed, or we just keep it there?
Well, everyone or anyone ought to have a first aid box.
All right.
Be it at home or be it at the workplace, be it in your car or in the public vehicles. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is, you might have the box, but you don't have the tools, the equipment there.
Yeah.
Well, you have it there, but it can never help you.
Mm-hmm.
So what ought to be the basic? I know there is a regulation from the government that there must be basic supplies in every first aid box.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter whether it's in a work, in the office, it doesn't matter whether it's home, it doesn't matter where, of course, where you are. But again, there is the prerequisite, where you are ought to have a specific number of items.
All right.
But generally, what you should be having in a first aid box is one, is dressings to stop the bleed, for cleaning a wound. Again, we have bandages now to wrap off, or maybe you have an injured or dislocated shoulder that you can try at least immobilize. Then another thing is antiseptic. The antiseptic come in different way. It could be case of Dettol or anything that can be used to clean. And the Dettol, again, you need to dilute it as you were using it when you're cleaning wound. Another thing that you ought to have in a first aid box is a certain sort of porcelain or a or some sort of a dish where you would put your liquid or the antiseptic for, where you can now, if you're cleaning a wound, you don't want to get the bottle and squeeze it in directly. You need to put it there where you can mix in, which is you call the galley pot or a kidney dish.
All right.
The other thing that you ought to have here is something that can cleanse your eyes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Especially for the children who get almost everything.
And here is not a medication. I'm not talking about the eye drops and stuff.
Right.
Just, it could be water for injection. This is just clean water that can be used for cleaning the eyes.
Yeah.
Yes. The other thing is scissors. You may need to cut gauzes. Then that's another thing that ought to be there. Safety pins.
Important.
They are very important. Because safety pins, they can be used for different ways. You have put a bandage and you want to hold it in there. It can be you have used a triangular bandage and you need to immobilize, you need to hold that with a pin. So that's again important.
Okay.
Those, the other thing is cotton wool, because the cotton wool now would be used now for cleaning, not where the wound is, directly where the injured is, but outside the wound. But I know some people would want to use cotton directly on the wound. The problem with the cotton wool is it's fluffy, so if you stop the dress with it, it will be left there.
And
so then
painful
later
to get
when
it
someone
out.
Is getting out, then it's very, very painful. Also, the other commonest, I know when people they have first aid bags, you must have is a surgical spirit.
Yes.
Now there is where we find that most people think that for surgical spirit is to be used directly on the wound.
It's not.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
See, that's the surgical spirit is meant for cleaning.
Yeah.
The equipment or the sterilizing, like the scissors you have used, the kidney dish or the galpo that you've used. Surgical spirit ought to cleanse. Round
the area,
yes, outside
okay,
the wound.
Then we've been doing
because
things
you
wrong.
Put it directly on the wound, what happened?
Yeah,
first of all, you really scream,
it is painful,
it is very
painful.
Yes, it's that should not be used directly on the wound. There's a misconception that most people think that's what you find. If I want to come and give you an injection, what do I do?
Most people
use it and rub it and you sterilize because it's meant for sterilizing non broken skin.
Okay.
When it is broken now, that's where you know what. Use the Dettol, which is diluted.
Antiseptic,
and, yes, the antiseptic or any other or iodine solution that you have in the box. Then you use it directly on the broken skin. The non-broken is outside.
Okay.
Yeah, where you use it on the surgical
spirit. You know, people use it like that, sort of like to stop bleeding.
It doesn't.
And,
it's actually
and all those things. Because I remember when I was in school and we were playing and then ended up hurting myself and the teacher was like, let us spirit and that and it was painful. So that is wrong.
Don't do it. You do not use surgical spirit directly on the wound. It's the same thing concept I've even find you go to a barber shop and they you know get a haircut.
Okay.
Next thing is they pour it and want to squeeze it and you go screaming and say, I'm very sterile. It's nothing like that.
Yeah. But
The why you scream is because you had microscopic cuts from the machine itself.
Yeah.
You see, that's why you're making water. But now, how do you sterilize that, or how do you cleanse wounds? Then that's why you put what? Put Dettol in the water, dilute it, because we put in water, you've already diluted. Then use that to clean. That is safe. Yes.
Okay.
But if it's someone now who is bleeding, then you can use now the Dettol the same way, or the other one, which is now iodine solution, which will be provided in a fasting box.
Okay.
Which now, the iodine, the good thing with iodine solution, you do not need to dilute it.
All right. Yeah, just use it as
it doesn't,
as
you
it
don't,
is.
Yes. Povidone, iodine, you don't need to dilute it.